and I disappeared.
I'm sure you can tell how much money that is. That's $1. That's $3. That's $5, and that's $323. Cognitive psychology says you can correctly estimate the number of objects when there is no more than five of them. When there's more, you need to count them. That doesn't seem like a huge issue, since we hardly ever need to be that precise when it comes to huge numbers in daily life. Yet, it makes me feel somewhat uncomfortable every time I think about this problem extending far beyond our perception. It's a problem of our imagination as well. My relationship with mathematics is a weird one. It absolutely fascinates me, and I can spend long hours doing research about math problems that, for the most part, I don't really understand, but there's something about the human side of mathematics that keeps me thinking about it over and over again. Let's take a look at this piece of paper, this beautiful piece of paper. It's A4 size, it's 0.1 millimeters thick, and there's certainly many things we can use this paper for, but I'm just going to fold it in half, so that now we can reflect on this incredible mathematical miracle. As you can probably guess, it is now 0.2 millimeters thick, as it doubled in thickness. And now I'm going to fold it again, so that now it's 0.4 millimeters thick. Not much of a surprise. I feel like I could continue folding the paper, but I wouldn't be able to do much more than 6, maybe 7 folds. But what is important is that, as you can tell, with each fold, the thickness doubles. Nevertheless, people are quite hesitant to accept the fact that folding that exact piece of paper only 14 times would make our paper about the size of an average woman. 16 times, so fold it twice more, and it's as tall as a giraffe. 22 times, to reach higher than the Eiffel Tower. 27 times, to reach higher than Mount Everest. 30 folds will take us to the height where we consider space to begin. At only 42 folds, we would have reached the moon. And finally, a piece of paper folded just 103 times would be longer than the entire observable universe, which, by the way, is around 93 billion light years long. This is an example of exponential growth, one of the most counterintuitive concepts that math have to offer. We simply can't comprehend how it is possible for a number to grow this fast. And I know this feels wrong. Trust me. I really do. But it gets much worse than that. And you might be thinking that I'm holding this deck of cards just so I can keep my hands busy while I'm talking, but there is obviously more to it, as it actually represents one of my favorite mathematical facts. This deck of cards represents infinity. Every time you properly shuffle a deck of cards, you have created a combination that has never appeared in the history of everything, ever. And I'm sure about that. And once again, I understand that it might just sound ridiculous, because a deck of cards seems so familiar, small, we can hold it in our hands, but I'm claiming it's as close to infinity as it can get. And I'm going to prove that to you. The number of possible combinations is 52 factorial, as there are 52 cards in a deck, which means that you first pick one card out of the 52 possibilities, then you take the second card out of the 51 possibilities left, and you work your way down. Therefore, to calculate the number of possible combinations, you multiply 52 times 51 times 50 all the way down to 1. That's 52 factorial. And intuitively, it does seem like a huge number, right? But so does a million or a billion. So how big is it? Well, it's around 8 followed by 67 zeros. This many zeros. Obviously, that means nothing, because as I said, humans can't comprehend such numbers. So let's put that into perspective. Let's assume that you can mark any leaf on the planet Earth so that I could recognize it. For example, you painted pink. Then you take that very leaf and hide it in any tree on Earth. For the sake of making the calculations, let's assume that every tree has leaves and not needles. And now, using the average number of leaves on a tree and the estimated number of trees on the planet, we can calculate the number of leaves on Earth. This is roughly how many leaves we have in the world. So, the chance that I would randomly choose the same exact leaf that you colored pink is about 1 in 6.08 times 10 to the 17th power. This is quite unlikely indeed. I could spend my entire life looking for your leaf and obviously never find it, because how could I? Yet this number is pretty much nothing compared to 52 factorial. In order for one leaf on the planet to represent one of the possible combinations of cards, we would have to have this many times more trees in the world. This should come as no surprise to anyone who knows the number of atoms on Earth, though, because we have roughly 1.33 times 10 to the 50th power of atoms, as even this number doesn't come remotely close to 52 factorial, as the power here is only 50 compared to 67. What this means is that there are pretty much infinitely more ways to shuffle a deck of cards than there are atoms on Earth. But I feel like my examples don't quite do this beautiful number justice. My favorite example comes from Scott Chipple, an American data scientist. Let's assume that we set a timer that will count down the number of seconds from 52 factorial to zero. So, just as a reminder, this is how many seconds are on the timer. Now imagine the following scenario. You stand on the equator, and you take one single step every billion years. You keep walking around the planet until you finish the entire world trip. When you do, take one single drop of water from the Pacific Ocean and continue walking. You keep walking around the planet and taking the single drops of water every time the world tour is complete. When the Pacific Ocean is completely dry, you take one single sheet of paper and place it on the ground. Now, fill the ocean back up and start the entire process all over again. You take a step every billion years. You take a single drop of water every time you finish the world trip, and you place a single piece of paper on the ground every time the Pacific Ocean is completely empty. When your stack of paper reaches the sun, which, by the way, is around 150 million kilometers away, we take a look at our timer again. This is what it looks like now. It barely changed. In order for the timer to reach zero, you would have to repeat the entire process of taking a step, removing water, and placing paper up to the sun 3,000 more times. This is what I meant by saying that this deck of cards represents infinity. And there is a reason why I'm talking about all of this. And it's not really about mathematics. It's about being human. When I first learned about all of these things, I felt absolutely overwhelmed. it's a weird feeling when you realize how limited your mind is and how it is seemingly not meant to understand the real scale of the world. Maybe we're never supposed to look at atoms, reach space, or wonder how many ways there are to shuffle a deck of cards. But here we are. We keep trusting our faulty minds, and we're doing just fine. And it took me some time to really understand that, ultimately, we don't have to comprehend everything. Because this realization that I hardly know anything about the world made me more of a conscious person. Everything is so random and huge. But every once in a while, it all makes sense. Even if we're not quite sure how. Thank you for your time.